Absolutely. So we have 51 people now. We had 110 register. Obviously, there's always going to be a few no-shows, but a lot of people will arrive a little bit late or have trouble with the link or whatever. So thank you all for arriving early. And we've got a wonderful program with you, and it's going to fill up the hour. And so if you're able to run a little bit late, we might do that. We're going to try very hard to get you out in an hour. So sorry for all the dinging in the background. I should have turned that off, but I don't know how to do that now that we're started. So hopefully that'll die down in a few minutes. So my name is Chris Carabinos. I'm the scouting coordinator for the United Methodist Church in the North Georgia Conference. And so we're the ones who are putting this event on tonight, along with PRA-Y. So we appreciate Jason and his team's support of this event. We got this idea. You'll see Reverend Scott Pickering there with a white background. He conducted the first virtual PRA-Y program I heard about back in April, like 3 weeks after COVID hit. And so he was telling me about it. And I said, well, how'd you do this? And why'd you do this? And how did it go? And ask 100 questions. And I said, you know, that's actually very doable. And he actually did a God in Me and a God in Family class. Next thing I know is I keep cogitating on it. I share it with Jason and Stephen Scheid and some others. And I find out that other people play around with this. And then since COVID is still with us, it occurred to us very few God in Country or PRA-Y programs are going to be held in person this fall or winter. So I said, well, that's a waste. Since we know how to, or at least some people know how to do one of these virtually using Zoom or Teams or whatever, I said, we should share that and try to get more churches and scout troops and packs and whatever to host these. So that's the genesis of this. And I said, well, Scott, would you mind letting me pepper you with questions on a Zoom call? He goes, sure. And I thought, well, let's get a panel. Let's get several people who have done this, and we get different perspectives. And people have done God in Me and done God in Life, maybe Jesus in Me. And so the more people we talked to, we found out more people have done this. And it's something a lot of people are thinking about. So that's the genesis of tonight. At the very least, we're going to have a casual conversation around this topic. As it turns out, when you guys registered, we asked you to check whether or not you had conducted a PRA-Y program or not before. 55% of you have conducted a PRA-Y program in person. Okay. I'm going to do a poll in a second to ask how many of you have actually done one virtually. This will be interesting to find out.
Okay. And I'm thinking if I did it by internet. I tried by internet on the computer.
Okay, sorry about that. Andrea, I went ahead and put you on mute there for a second. Okay, so anyway, as I mentioned, we have about 110 registrants from 28 states and 4 time zones. We have 2 people from Alaska. A number of you guys found out about this from the Scatters Religious Academy. We helped host back in May. If you guys could put yourself on mute, we'd appreciate it as you join. Okay, thank you. And so it's great to see you guys again. We partnered with the Atlanta Archdiocese Catholic Committee on Scouting back then to host it. And we'll be doing that again. And I'll share some information at the end of tonight's program if you're interested in attending that again. We do have 18 Methodist conferences represented here tonight, which is amazing, including I see Jim Leppert with Northern Illinois Conference, and also Bill Chafin with the Virginia Conference, and Carolyn Rudisill with the Texas Conference out of Houston. And so we've got a lot of folks here. Really appreciate you guys promoting it. We also have 25 Girl Scout professionals and volunteers, large contingent of Girl Scouts. We have 7 ministers and 4 youth ministers. So about 10% of tonight's registered crowd is or ministers of one type or another. That's awesome to see. The largest single scout position is religious emblem coordinator. So 17 of you guys are RECs, or religious emblem coordinators at the district, the troop level, whichever. And so this is a perfect course for you guys to share with the folks in your district, your troop, or wherever. And then also we have 14 CORs. So we got a great diversity of leadership here. So tonight's seminar is going to be for a couple things here. You have the ability to modify your name if you'd like to. If you look at mine, it says UMC, North Georgia. If you look at Stephen Scheid, his says Nashville. Jenny has Wesley, United Methodist Church. If you'd like to modify your name to put your city or your state or your council or what program you're with, feel free to do that. That'd be fun. You could maybe, as you go through the program tonight, you can see who else shares an interest or a geography of yours. And the way you do that is hover over your own name. You click the three dots in the upper right corner and you'll see a menu drop down. Go down to rename and you can just type in whatever you want. Okay, so that's just one logistical thing. The chat room is live and open. I see a number of you guys are using that. That's awesome. So please feel free to, if you want to follow the conversation and add to it, if you have a question, you could pose a question in there. In fact, that is the place to ask questions, okay? So Malcolm Wills, who you see on one of the pages here, he's going to be my right arm or our right arm for the night. And so at a certain point in the program, we'll open it up for questions, and then Malcolm is going to help us go through and find out. Some of these may be simple questions to answer or to ask and answer, and he may just help answer those in the chat room, okay? And that's fine. If you guys want to ask and answer yourselves, help each other out, feel free. The other part of the interactive is obviously asking questions, and so we'll open it up towards the later part of the program because we guys, you probably have some questions. We want to make sure you get your questions answered. For those of you guys who just joined in the last few minutes, we are recording this. I'll send out a follow-up email, if not tonight, tomorrow, with a link to the recording so you can share it with other people or listen to it again. We'll also send out an attachment or two that we're going to refer to during the program tonight. And also these items will be saved in a couple of places. On the United Methodist Community Scouting website here in Atlanta, but also Jason is going to save it to his PRAY website. So you'll find it in the virtual resources section there. And also Stephen Shy is going to save it for the United Methodist Committee on Scouting, or excuse me, the United Methodist Scouting Committee has a website with the General Commission on UMM. And so he'll put it out there as well. So I think I've covered all the logistical notes. So let me go ahead. Oh, the one last thing, if you're new to Zoom and you see a bunch of pictures on there, that's great. But in a moment, I'm going to share my screen and you want to be able to see the screen large. So if you go up to the right corner of your Zoom screen, it says view and it's got a little 3x3 dot. You click on that and click on speaker view. And then you'll be able to see who is speaking. And I'm going to actually share my screen at this point so that you can actually see the presentation. So can somebody tell me if they see a PowerPoint on the screen?
Yep. Good. Okay.
Yes. Okay. Yes, it's there.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Okay. All right. So tonight we're going to cover the PRA.Y basics. We set this up thinking that most of the attendees would have done PRA.Y already, and they're just looking to do to understand how to do the PRA.Y program virtually. Well, as I mentioned before, that's really not the case. A lot of folks have never done a PRA.Y program before. So we're going to cover a couple of the PRA.Y basics just so you can understand what the programs are. We do have other programs, either Jason does or we do or Stephen does, that are recorded and some really good information if you want to go deeper into PRA.Y and what that's about. And if you're looking for information like that, let me ask you to put it in the chat line and just say, I'd like some more detailed information about PRA.Y and put your name in there and then I can follow up with you afterwards. The bulk of the program tonight will be a panel discussion and I'll introduce the panel in a minute. And it's that sort of fireside chat approach that we're going to have with this. We'll have some open Q&A and then at the end, we're going to share some information on some other faith-based scouting activities coming up. So before I get into it any further, I'm going to share a poll with you. And so I just launched a poll. Hopefully you'll see it. And the question is, have you conducted an in-person PRA.Y course before of any level, whether it's Jesus and Me or God and Life? And I know we took this information during the registration period, but I want to see what kind of folks we have here, or what kind of crowd we have here tonight. And so the answers are yes, no, or I am organizing my first. Okay.
Should we respond if we haven't already?
Yeah, go ahead and respond. So we've had 44 people out of 54 respond. The reason the 54 doesn't equal to 58 is some of us are co-hosts and we can't vote. So the panelists, myself, we can't vote. So we've got 48 out of 54. I'll just wait another couple seconds and I'll close it. And we have 50. Okay, give it 5 seconds. Great. So I'm gonna end the poll and let me share the results. And you'll see that 30 or 60% of you have conducted PRA.Y before, a third or 34% have not, and 3 of you are conducting your first. Excellent. So we got a nice, distribution there. So appreciate that very much. So let's go to the next poll. And how do I get to the next poll? Come on. There it is. So this poll is, have you conducted a virtual P.R.A.Y. course before? So we'll go ahead and give it about 30, 45 seconds. If everybody who can vote will vote. Well, you guys are on top of it now. We're up to 85% already. Oh, okay, this is interesting. Okay, so we've had five, or basically 10% of the people have conducted a P.R.A.Y. course before. So in addition to the three panelists, that would be five, that would be eight total in the crowd tonight. And then most of you haven't. Okay, perfect. Thank you very much. So that gives us and the panelists and yourselves an idea of the folks in the room. Okay, so let's cover some basic information about P.R.A.Y. This is a Bible-based education program. It is Protestant-focused. It is usable in for 21 different Protestant independent Christian faith traditions. Oh, another point I found very interesting is we have 10 people who registered for tonight who are Catholic, which I find interesting because obviously they have their dedicated program. But it's really good because most of our troops have kids of all faiths, whether Boy Scout or Girl Scout troops. And so it's helpful to understand how other faith programs work so you can help your kids of all faiths get into the program. So I'm glad to see you guys with us tonight. P.R.A.Y. is a faith partner for the Catholic Emblem curriculum, as well as Community Christ, Eastern Orthodox, and the Jewish program. And so they'll actually process the books and the awards for those faith groups. So even though they publish their own materials, the publishing house, if you will, distribution center that P.R.A.Y. has is really efficient. So it's utilized by all those faith groups. They are an agency partner with American Heritage Girls, Boy Scouts of America, and the Girl Scouts USA. And I believe there's also some other groups like Trail Life and some others that use them as well. You don't have to be one of those organizations to use it, but they have official partnerships with those organizations. And in fact, I know whenever I've taught it, we've always opened it up to Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts and no Scouts. You don't even have to be in a program to take this program at all. Mm-hmm. So the program is comprised of five basic program levels, and then also something called Bible Basics RP3. So it starts in kindergarten through first grade in Jesus and Me. The God and Me used to cover first, second, third grade, and they just changed it this year, according to Jason, where God and Me is now only for second and third grade. And I think that just took place this year, or maybe even this fall. And then God and Family is fourth, fifth, and sixth grade. And God and Church is the sixth, seventh, and eighth. I also understand from Jason that that is going to become just fourth and fifth grade only, I believe. And then God and Life is high school years, the ninth through 12th grade. And the idea is that there are youth-oriented programs as well as adult mentor programs. And, of course, there's moderator programs with the booklets. And all of these are available through Girl Scout and Boy Scout shops. You can order them from P.R.A.Y. online. We'll show you the website in a little bit about where to order these things if you don't have access to them or your scout shop's not open. And also, they're starting to virtualize these things where you have them digitally. You don't have to buy the book anymore. In fact, the God and Family one, Jason, he's going to announce tonight that you can actually, is totally downloadable and totally manageable virtually. Okay. And also you had the Bible Basics RP3 program. And this is meant to, because Jesus and Me, you can take once in that 2-year period. God and Me, you can take once in that 2-year period, except. So you can only take it once at each level. And so Bible Basics are educational programs you can take in the other years during one of these levels so that you can continue to educate your kids and so they can continue on their journey. Okay. So again, just very high level, we're gonna share some more information as we get into this, but I just wanted to share that with you. So here's tonight's panel. I'll play the role of moderator. Jason Nolan, Executive Director of P.R.A.Y., was planning on being here, but he had a bit of a emergency tonight, so he's not able to join us, but we'll cover his material here. And the panel that we have assembled is perfectly greatly experienced and be able to handle all the questions that we have. All three, Reverend Scott Pickering, Kristen Rogan, and John Anderson, have conducted in-person and virtual pray sessions on multiple levels. So this is a very experienced panel here. Okay. So I'm going to ask each of you guys just to do a quick introduction of yourselves. People can see what your primary role here as it relates to this here. But if you could just give a snippet about your scouting background, what levels of the PRA program you've taught, I'd appreciate that. And that's, I'm sure the audience would too. Scott, if you could lead off.
So I'm Scott Pickering. I'm in the Atlanta, Georgia area. And I have typically taught the God in me and God in family. And the main reason for that is that when I was a scout, I didn't find out about PRA until I was in high school. And you cannot go back and earn the other levels. So I want to go ahead and expose the kids as quickly as possible to the program so that they can do the whole program throughout their scouting career.
Excellent. Kristen.
Hi, my name is Kristen Rogan. I am from Mid-Iowa Council in Iowa. I've been in scouting for probably, let's see, about 18 years almost. I've been with doing PRA programs for about 15 years. I've done all levels from Jesus and Me all the way to God in Life. So I've done both virtual and in person.
And also you're on the conference, National Lutheran Association.
Association of Scouting, yes.
Excellent. So we're not all Methodists here tonight. We have other groups too. So thank you, Kristen, for joining us. And John.
Yes, been a Cubmaster, Scoutmaster. I have been the Western Region Scout Coordinator for the United Methodist Church. That covers the 12 Western states. The local church coordinator as well for scouting in the church. The Council Religious Emblems Coordinator, and I have taught virtual class in God and Life. And over the last 15 years, I've counseled or taught 171 kids for the awards. So I've had mostly in class, but now I'm venturing into virtual classes as well.
Excellent, excellent. So guys, as you can tell, we have a really deep set of experiences here. The one we couldn't find, and we looked, was somebody who has experience leading Girl Scouts through a virtual program. So if you're a Girl Scout leader and you led a virtual program, if you could put a note out there in the chat room to let me know that, we'd love to identify folks like that. So we tried and we just couldn't find anybody in the time we had to put this together. So thank you, panelists, for joining us tonight. So I'm going to go ahead and go through some questions. And if you guys have questions, you can put them in the chat room or just sort of hold them and when we get to that part of the program. And I'm going to start off real basic and easy, and then we'll get to the more robust questions, if you will. So the first question I'm going to ask you, Kristen, what is the ideal class size for an online PRA course in your mind?
Basically, it depends on what class you're actually teaching first. If you're teaching the Jesus in Me, you're probably going to look at probably a smaller class size just because of the content and who you're working with. Jesus in Me, of course, is kindergarten, first grade, so they're not as technology savvy yet for these virtual meetings. So and their parents are going to be helping them a lot, so a little bit more one-on-one type thing. You could do the larger class sizes with the God in Life, just because those class sizes are easier to maintain. A larger class size is easier to maintain with those older kids. The smaller groups, I would say probably minimum of 6 to 10 for the smaller classes, and then you can go up from there for many of the bigger classes.
Gotcha. Okay, that's very good. So John, what do you think is the ideal session length? And is it different for different level programs? And I guess a B part of that might be number of sessions, you know, and does it equate to sort of a three-part question, I suppose. And does that equate to each session that you would do in a normal in-person environment?
Well, actually, the length of the sessions are dependent, whether it's be in class or whether it be virtual, on the age of your students. For instance, for the kindergarten and first graders, I try to limit that to about a 45-minute session. When I get to next phase for the God and Me kids, the second through third graders, I'll set those sessions at an hour. And then the next two for family, God and church, I'll set those at an hour and a half. And then for the high school kids, that particular class is very discussion-based. And sometimes those will start at 1.5 hours, but we might go 2 hours on that one. But those are high school kids that can handle that better than the youngsters.
Gotcha. So I guess if you're managing the Jesus and Me and Me and Family courses to 45 minutes, then you might need more sessions in order to get through all the material than you would.
For the most part, I've been able to do a whatever it be, a session or a chapter or whatever, meeting. However, occasionally, depending upon the size of the class, if you've got a large class and you got a lot of students that want to speak about the answers that they've given in their workbooks, then sometimes it'll need an extra session. But for the most part, at least in class, I've been able to cover each session or chapter class. Now, the God and Life, there I've had to add some extra sessions because those are more detailed requirements at the higher age level. The discussions can become very interesting, but can get rather detailed, and I don't like to restrict that. So we will add extra if need be.
Gotcha. Let me just ask if everybody in the audience, if you could mute yourselves, we'd appreciate that. I think most of you are muted, but if you're not, that'd be appreciated so we don't have interrupting noise. So sort of a follow-up question there, John, is I know in God and Church, and particularly God and Life, you got service projects you have to do. So how do you manage the service projects in a virtual environment?
Well, I'm involved in that right now because I've got two scouts that are working on that. And what we've done, they picked their project out of the list on the book or in the book, or they come up with their own project. And then I have to approve that first. Then they go and perform that project on their own. We get back together in a Zoom meeting, and then we go over the project individually as a Zoom group. And then after that, what we've set up here is I have a Dropbox, and they'll drop their books, and I'll sign off their books, and then they goes back in the Dropbox, and then they pick them up later.
Excellent.
That's my current methodology there, and we're all the way to session five in God and Life. We're almost done, and it's worked very well for my first experiment.
I know when I taught my youngest son the God and Church program, when I led about six boys through that program, they chose a service project where they did a joint film project, and it was role playing certain things. It was like 15 years ago, so I don't know if that's still an option on that kind of a project. And they had the greatest fun, but I know some of those projects that are listed as options are joint team projects, and I can imagine that might be a bit of a challenge in COVID times. But I'm sure you could pick up other projects that don't require that kind of teamwork.
Yeah, we haven't had that issue yet. But again, I haven't done a God and Church yet.
And virtually, right.
That's a good one, though, because I've had several students that have done the video option in God and Church and
gotcha. Okay.
And the stop action Lego projects.
Gotcha. Scott, let me ask you, do you want or need parents to be in the virtual room during a session?
I definitely like having that. The parents are in the room with them. They don't have to be necessarily sitting right beside the scout or the youth, but to have them in a room, sort of like a supervisory person from that end as well, is helpful for any problems that might come up with the computer or something like that, to be able to have a parent there to help address the need. Mm-hmm.
And hopefully the parents aren't butting in and offering their advice or their answers.
Yeah, there's some safety reasoning too behind having the parents in the room. You know, in Boy Scouts in particular, there's the youth protection, and you know, you're supposed to have two deep leadership. And in a sense, even though it's in a virtual format and I'm an adult that's nowhere physically near a kid, it's good to have that extra parent there to be a witness to how the program is going and what's going on.
Well, that also protects you as a leader, so that a child can't later come back and said you said something that you didn't say or something.
Exactly. So
it protects everybody. That's a great point. So Kristen, it sort of follows the safety protection thing. Can you or should you record an online session? Do you have any thoughts on that?
I think it all depends on a lot of things with scouting. You have youth protection for one, but you would also have a sign off or a parent agreement that yes, you are able to use pictures or videos or anything like that in your recruiting for, you know, stuff like that. I would say that as long as you have permission from the parents, then yes, I would say yes. If you don't have permission from the parents to record anything with children in that, then I would say no.
Gotcha. So John or Scott, did you have anything to add to that?
Well, I think that the one thing that I've noticed, if we're still on the do parents need to be in the room?
Well, I think both of these are sort of these, there's separate answers, but also there's a joint answer there too, or joint conversation to be had around that too. So you can go ahead and talk to that one if you like.
Well, that one, I did want to comment that I find, well, I have it as a requirement, especially for the younger students, because they need guidance and they need supervision. So whether it's in class or whether it's on video, they need to have the parent right there. And for the high school kids, if they've got a parent in the room, that's too deep leadership, and I'm fine with that.
Yeah, we definitely want to recommend too deep leadership. I know the Girl Scouts have a similar policy too, so we want to make sure that the youth is protected, and then we're protected as adults as well.
Chris, I would just jump in real quick, though, and just point out too that in most states, there's the mandatory reporting if you come across child abuse or child neglect. And I think even in a virtual world, sometimes as we're peering into people's homes, there may be a situation that occurs that we might find ourselves potentially having to say, I need to report this incident.
That's a good point. Say, Don Shapley, if you could mute yourself, I could see you. You've got a lot of noise coming through.
Sorry.
That's okay. Just your. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Thanks, Scott. I appreciate that too. Kristen, we've got you down for this one in Jason's place here. Are there any particular virtual technology platforms you might recommend, be it Zoom that we're using here, Teams, WebEx, Skype, anything like that?
I've actually used several of these. I've used Zoom, I've used WebEx, I've used GoToMeetings, I've used Google Meet. So I've used all of those platforms. I have found that, like with Google Meet, there's some things in there that it's harder to control. It's harder to get the kids to actually mute themselves if they need to mute. So you don't have a whole lot of control of the environment. Zoom, you actually have that administration capability of actually being able to mute the whole group if you need to, if there's something that's going on. Or you can actually turn off their video as well. We've learned that one in the past, where you could actually block their video so they can't be a disruption in that way. But I think Zoom is a very good one. So is GoToMeeting, and so is WebEx. The Google Meet is a little less capability, but it's really good for smaller groups.
Ah, that's a good point. So John, do you have a perspective on that?
I've just worked with the Zoom as my mode, and That's the only one that we've dealt with, and it works very well.
Gotcha. Okay, good. Scott, how much time do you plan for students talking and presenting versus you moderating? Or do you even get that much thought? I mean,
usually I want to get the kids involved. So I work, like I said, primarily with the God in me and God in family. So the presenting portion might be only about a third of the class, but at least two thirds of the class is going to be the kids chiming in, wanting to share what their perspectives are on the different questions, or be a part of the conversation rather than just being a lecture to.
Gotcha. Kristen, is that your experience too? Or since you teach some older groups too, what's your experience?
I pretty much the same. There's really not a big difference on that one.
Okay, gotcha. So I need to ask somebody besides Scott this. So I'm going to go to Kristen, you on this one. How do you engage clergy in the program? Because Scott's real easy. He's there already. So how do you engage clergy in the program?
I have a different perspective on that one, because most of the kids that I have taught classes to are class kids that don't have a home church. So I always have to go in and actually engage clergy to see if they would like to help participate with those programs and get them involved. So I've always tried to get them to come in. They'll come in and help sing songs. They'll help lead prayers. They'll come into each class and just kind of check on things, see how things are going. But I always have them come in and do their final reviews together. I always have the pastors or the minister come in and actually do a final review and actually get to know the kids throughout the class, but I definitely have them come in and do their final review together.
So Scott, since you're on the ministerial side, what advice would you have for those of us who are looking to engage the clergy?
If it's a clergy person who doesn't have a history with scouting or Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, whatever, it's really good to try and bring them in for an easy win. What makes them look good at the least amount of effort, so to speak? So that might be just welcome them to the church at the very first meeting that they're there. It could progress to the pastor, inviting the pastor to teach a segment of the program. And it could even be something as relaxed as introducing the pastor and the pastor each week having an opening prayer and maybe an icebreaker before the actual meat of the substance begins. But any of those type of activities that are where we invite you in for a moment and the clergy is not having to worry about planning the whole class, those are usually great ways to try to bring in the clergy participation. And then, of course, like Kristen said, the award ceremony is always a great, great time to ask the pastor to come say a prayer and help present the medals.
So if I have a group of kids who are like Christians sometimes, where they don't go to church anywhere, should I feel concerned about asking you as a minister, these aren't your kids, they don't go to church anywhere, about whether or not you would help support, or most ministers willing to help, or are they only looking to help with kids out of their church?
I think for clergy, a lot of time it's the time, whatever the time requirement is. Mm-hmm. And if the clergy has kids, of course, that are in the programs, it's no big deal. You know, usually they're already invested in the scouting programs that they participate in. But if the pastor doesn't have a child in the scouting program or has very little knowledge about the PRA-Y program, it's easier to bring them in for an intro, so to speak. And usually most clergy, I think, would not proselytize the kids, so to speak, just for the purpose of their church's own benefit. Right. That could happen. But I think most pastors that get involved with PRA-Y are just excited that kids want to learn more about Jesus.
Yeah, that's been my experience. I have talked to other PRA-Y mentors or leaders, facilitators, that they're a little concerned about finding a minister who will participate in the program with kids that don't go to the church. They're thinking ministers are only interested in kids that go to the church. I don't think that's really the case. You might find an odd case like that. I think most ministers are willing to help talk about Christ in any setting.
I agree.
And I think a lot of a lot of ministers might look at this as an opportunity. I get to engage with a child and her mother, and actually maybe I can invite them to, you know, Scout Sunday to make their presentation of the award and maybe get them introduced. So, you know, not to be so crass, but it could be a recruiting opportunity. And so
it's an outreach ministry.
Exactly right. That's exactly
very much so. I can second that, because our pastor makes sure that he comes, drops in occasionally, but because of time constraints, he actually does the final review with each and every student and their family together. And we have gotten church members from that exercise. So he's very happy to help.
Excellent.
And I've had two or three ministers over the 15 years that have all wanted to handle it in that manner.
Excellent. Hey, Chris, we have an interesting question from the gallery here. Sure. The reason I'm bringing this up is it's probably a situation a lot of people are going to be faced with currently. Somebody mentioned that they're running into roadblocks because ministers right now, clergy is very focused on how to get churches started up safely. So doing a PRA program might fall to the bottom of the totem pole. I don't know if Scott has any suggestions about how to, you know, encourage clergy that all parts of the church, even in this challenging environment, are important?
Excellent question. Scott, you got a thought on that?
I would say that the most difficulty that I've encountered is actually from the Boy Scout Council, more so than from a church. And it's because the Boy Scout Council is so busy trying to reopen, so to speak. That they're not really out there to promote the program as they would have back in April when it was all brand new and they were trying to come up with some way to get the program out.
I'm also thinking that a virtual program like this might be a great way for the church to engage the community, because this is an outreach program. And it's a light lift for them, especially to get a volunteer like one of us on this call tonight who's willing to actually do the heavy lifting and just bring them in for light touches, as Scott was suggesting. So it's a great way to impact youth for Christ in our case. And so I would actually turn that around saying, this is an easy lift for you and we'll get ready to do the work. So
we can also, sorry, Chris, sorry.
No, go ahead.
We can also let the pastors know that it's not, they don't have to do the program. They can appoint people to work with it. With the kids. They can appoint people to actually do these programs within the church. It's not necessarily that the pastor's job to actually complete the program for them. Mm-hmm.
So Chris, I'm going to ask the next question for you. What resources did you use when you put this virtual program on?
I pulled everything I could possibly pull off the PRA website. I scanned it in. I made it PowerPoints. I did everything I possibly could to, because I started the program as a face-to-face back in February with actually started four different classes. And so we started face-to-face and then COVID hit and boom, nothing.
So
and
you so had to pivot halfway through the course.
Correct. Courses. And so I had to take four different classes and pull the program off of the PRA website, basically, and create my own virtual classrooms.
Interesting.
So basically, I used every web a piece of paper that they had on their website to actually pull the things together and make PowerPoints, and so I could share my screen and do things like that. So a lot of stuff that I did, I talked to Jason about afterwards and said, this would have been helpful.
Gotcha.
But yeah, Bibles, everything. I mean, I pretty much scanned everything I could possibly scan in just so that I could have stuff I could put on the screen for them to actually see.
So for the audience, when we get done with this in Q&A, we're going to show you some of the resources she's talking about. Many of you probably been to the PRA website. If you haven't, it is chock full of content and stuff for you to download. So I think they were ahead of the curve when they were thinking about doing things like this. So it's great to hear that you had to pivot halfway through your course and had to adjust on the fly.
Yeah, we did finish up virtually, which was kind of different, but yeah, we did. The kids did a great job.
Right. So John, I think we sort of touched on this before, but I want to go ahead and ask the question since we listed it and see if you might have an additional thought. But what factors should we consider for youth protection and child safety when doing a virtual class?
It's pretty much what we've already talked about with the 2D leadership.
Okay.
A little bit farther to that, though, specifically, if you refer to the BSA social media guidelines, mm-hmm. to the extent of email. If you are emailing something to a scout, you need to copy a parent or copy some other responsible adult. So that is an electronic 2D. So that's mm-hmm. important that we follow those guidelines.
Excellent, excellent. Scott, anything else you would add to that?
Again, no, I think spoke to it, but I just concur.
Okay, good. So, John, I got another question for you is, how do you recognize participants? And I think you just went through this in the last week or three, right? You've conducted the program. How do you recognize people virtually?
I did that just this past Sunday. We had a recognition virtually via Zoom for 10 Girl Scouts that had earned their awards, and they were due to get them on mid-March. But we closed the church here a week before their ceremony. So therefore, we've been trying to come up with an idea, and finally we settled on we're not going to wait any longer. And we did it via Zoom, and I have been told by the participants that they thought it was a great success, so I now have a template.
Sorry, I was trying to unmute and I hit the go forward slide, my bad. So have you shared that with Jason, the template you're talking about?
Not yet. Like I said, it just happened this past Sunday.
Okay, now that it works.
I definitely plan to do it because it went smoothly, which I was afraid of, having not done something like that before, and good comments. So excellent. I think we got a plan.
So Kristen or Scott, have you guys had experience with the recognition in these COVID times?
We are still planning ours for the kids that did theirs. We were hoping to open up before so we could actually do our presentation for all of our classes. But I've got kids that are not scouts and scouts and in different packs. So I'm trying to schedule a one big presentation.
So it sounds like you and John may be talking in the near future.
Yes, I may have to have a talk with him.
So. And you, yeah, because normally speaking, Chris, we bring everybody in on Boy Scout Sunday in February, on Girl Scout Sunday in March. Whether they're scouts or not, doesn't make any difference. And we have myself and the pastor to go through the recognition and presentations right in front of the congregation so that the congregation sees what value this has to our youth.
Nice. Okay. So before I move on to the next one, Scott, I'd mention giving you the opportunity to answer that too, if you like.
I think you could do the award presentation, so to speak, as a video too, and use that as a source to either play on Scout Sunday or Girl Scout Sunday, or it's a source that you can place on your Facebook if you got the parents' permission, so that, you know, perhaps like the group did a class project to help clean up a park nearby. That's great stuff for people in churches to see, and people in the scouting community to be able to see this is something that we all share an interest in, and look at how everybody came together for that opportunity.
That's good. I like that. And so, Chris, so virtual Zoom here, you could actually record it, again, getting everybody's permission.
One of the things that we did, Chris, is the church recorded it this past Sunday, and they're going to put it on the church website.
Oh, nice. Now, that's great. That helps them. It helps you recruit the next class. It does a lot of things.
And hey, Chris. Chris, a couple things came into the chat that I thought I need to bring up real quick. There was an excellent question asked about how PRA relates to the My Promise, My Faith pen.
Great. So for those of you who may not know My Promise, My Faith, that is a Girl Scout faith-based program. And I have not taught that program. I'm going to ask Stephen Scheid. You're on the line. Or is Cara Ball here? I know she was signed up to come. I don't know if she made it tonight. Cara, are you in the room?
Hey, yes, I'm on. But if Stephen would like to share some remarks, that would be fine as well. Okay,
let me ask a question.
Okay, I'll jump in and then Stephen can add to it. So hi, everybody. I'm Cara Ball with Girl Scouts GSUSA. The My Promise, My Faith pin is a pin that Girl Scouts puts forth that a girl can earn every year. And it's basically five steps where a girl of any faith can connect her her own particular faith to her leadership journey. And it involves connecting Girl Scouts, a line of the Girl Scout law to a story or some other part of a girl's faith, and connecting with also a woman in her faith tradition and a few other steps. But the last step of the My Promise, My Faith pin points girls directly to the PRAY program or the religious emblem program of their faith tradition, so that it's a way to go deeper. So the My Promise, My Faith is a way for girls of multiple faiths to study together their own faith traditions, learn more about each other's faith, but also then points them to learn more about their own, the tenets and beliefs of their tradition, and ultimately to earn their religious awards, and including the PRAY awards.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Carl. Appreciate it. I'm glad you made it tonight.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And especially so you can answer that question, because I would have fumbled it. Well, Malcolm, we're out of our questions here. Do you have some other questions in the chat room?
There was one statement that was brought up about recording sessions and protecting the identity of children. So we need to make sure that we've got that addressed, because even if you've given permission for photos to be taken, we want to make sure that the identities of the children are protected at all times.
Thank you for that. Yeah, I made a mistake when Scott did a screenshot at his class. He sent it to me and I shared it with folks, and Stephen Scheid on the call here goes, I think we ought to block out the names on there, which we did immediately before we started sharing it. So that's an excellent point, whoever brought that up.
If I may, Chris, with our video recording of Sunday's presentation for the Girl Scouts, we made it specific that we mentioned by first name only, and that there was no reference to what school they went to or anything else that could be tied back. So we were trying to be aware and take that consideration.
Excellent points. I'm glad somebody brought that up. Go ahead.
Also, for the names, when, like you said, we get to change our names on here. We always put the parents' names instead of the kids' names on the call. Or when we
did
our Zoom, so.
Okay. Malcolm, are there any other questions in the chat room?
Yeah, one just came in, which is really a great question, I think. How do you keep, or suggestions on making the virtual class interesting? So Scott put some suggestions there. So if you definitely want to look in the chat, he has about 7 or 8 interesting suggestions on how to keep kids engaged, because we know that kids are kind of zoomed out these days with virtual learning from school and other areas. So I thought that I wanted to make sure that everybody at least looked at that, because there's some great suggestions by Scott in the chat for that.
Well, we actually have a couple of minutes, and I think that's we had that as an alternative question, but I wanted to get to the questions in the chat room. But let's go ahead and address that one, because that is something. Scott, would you mind speaking to that?
So one of the great things about the Zoom was that it does have that mute all button, and that came in very helpful, especially with those younger kids, being able to control the room, so to speak, more so than what you can do in a face-to-face gathering with them. But kids are looking for things that are changing, something that's exciting, and sometimes looking at those workbooks, you get bored of looking at those workbooks, because you see books at school, you see books at church, you see books now at PRAY. But one of the things that we did was like the Kim's game, that is one of the activities in one of the God and Family or God and Me books, where you look at the different items of communication, and then you let them see all these objects, and then you tell them that they have to close the book and try to recall which ones have come back that they saw. So you can do that in real life too. So one of the things I have in my office is a red rotary telephone, just like you might envision with being in the White House or something like that. But you have to go through all the explaining of, yes, you had to stick your finger into a little hole and roll it around to get there. But kids love to see old things like that or things that they might not have ever used before. And it helps make a connection about all the tools in this day and age that we actually use to communicate. So the Kim's game is a great example of bringing that out. The other part is, you know, there, in the God and Family, there's a part of the program where they have to make a piece and write the name of their family members and something good about them. Well, you can imagine how you can do that as a virtual activity where the kids are able to bring their parents, bring their sister, their brothers, and they will say, this is my brother, and he really hates broccoli, so I request broccoli every night. You know, just something to get the dynamics of the kids, and it's a great way for them to be able to show and tell. And because of the mute all button, you can guarantee that the kid can have a pretty good way of being able to present what's important to them and their family without being lost in a classroom that would be a whole bunch of people trying to chime in. Sort of like a presidential debate.
That's great. I appreciate that. So before we move on to other things, and we are sort of in the open question session, Malcolm, are there any others that have come up or that you'd like to share?
No direct questions, but Jenny White did state that they had a theme each week. So, you know, they had to dress up, hats, sunglasses, other things to keep the kids engaged. So I thought that was a good suggestion as well. Each week that you have a class, it's a different theme. So that probably helps keep it a little live.
Excellent. Good. Well, let's go ahead and move on. And so I am going to sort of recap some of the best practices that you heard here. And we're actually have captured this in a separate document, a 2-page Word document. So I will email that out in the thank you attendance note, along with the link to the recording here. And so you guys can print that off. But some of the highlights here, you want to email parents and the students before and after each session. Once you get into it, maybe just one email recapping what you had before and what the instructions are for the next one. But the before is to deliver material about the next session, provide directions. The afterwards is to follow up with verification of completed tasks if the kids need to do something to finalize completion of something, or if there's some direction about follow-up activities. I think you heard 6 to 10 students, smaller class size for the younger groups, maybe larger class sizes. I think John or Kristen said maybe you can take up to 10 or 12, totally dependent on you as the facilitator of the course. But a good size is 8. You want to have a parent in a room, especially K through 5th grade. The parent does not have to be on the screen, but just in the room to help ensure there's 2-deep leadership and also help keep the child focused. Have the students talk about their work. Don't turn into a lecture where you're lecturing to them. I like what Scott said. I think he said 1/3, 2/3 or something about that, or he's actually talking about 30% and they're doing most of the talking because they're supposed to be reporting out to you. Think about time limits. John shared that he manages to about 45 minutes in the first couple levels, especially Jesus and Me and God and Me, and then maybe up to 1.5 hours with the high schoolers. So, and depending on the size of the class, that's a factor as well. If you have a smaller class, you can have a more shorter time frame, that kind of thing. In some of the classes, and depending on the size and the age, you might consider spreading the chapters out over more sessions, or you might be able to cover a whole session if you're in one session, in one Zoom session, that, if you will. Service projects, where John shared a couple of ideas that he's done with that. The basic students are working on their own service project. Coordinating on service projects is challenging in these COVID times. If you had siblings in the same family and they're in that little one, you don't call it a bubble, you call it a pod, they can obviously go do things together. So you might consider that. The PRAY tools that we talked about here, I'm gonna go ahead and pop this up for you. PRAY's got an awesome website. And this is the resource library. general resources. They've got a couple different places of this. You can get into Girl Scouts, Bible Basics, Boy Scouts. You can see all the different categories they have here. And they have the different levels. Of course, a lot of Girl Scout specific information here around the Bible Basics. Okay. And then they get into like the Jesus and Me level. They have all these downloadable PDFs and documents. And some of these, especially like God and Family, where you do the pizza thing, they have some downloadable documents where you can actually cut out to make the pizza pieces, if you will. And so you can send those to your families. And so this, you can see how extensive this goes and goes. When you get to the recognition part, they have a bunch of information here. And you can see where Eastern Orthodox and Jewish and the other faith groups too, because they do are sort of like a clearinghouse for all of these different faith groups, as I mentioned before. And then there's a session here on virtual learning. So they're really, they were ahead of the game with COVID, and now Jason and their team is adding, they're adding a lot of different items out here too. So this recording will be out here as well as some of the other documentation, the best practices and those kind of things, okay? And so some of these are for promotional purposes, and some of these are for actually conducting the class, if you will, okay? So let me go back here. That goes to the virtual learning sites, which I just showed with you. On that site is a video on pray emblems in the home. So they've actually got a video to help educate those of us who are teaching the program. They have letters to the pastor, from the family or the counselor. You can see some of the other items here. They also have teaching videos for parents or the counselors, okay? And they're broken out by lesson. So again, a lot of great resources out there. And you can see the others. A lot of these, it seems to be a little redundant. So we may have actually included that twice. There's also a 30-day challenge. There's roadmap and tasks that you can complete an emblem in 30 days. And so that's available. So you might look at under the resources library as well. And they also have, there's some eligibility extension because of the COVID-19 issue, especially towards the end of last year. Because once you go from like third grade into fourth grade, you can't go back and take the ME course anymore. You got to take the next one. But they have some exceptions because of the COVID. So you can check into that as well. So before I move on to that, are there any other resources that our panelists have utilized that weren't mentioned here specifically that you would like to share?
I would say just a reminder that if you have adults who are helping with the program, always look at those ways that you can recognize and give adult recognition. And usually once you do that, that definitely secures the buy-in of that person in the program. So just a reminder that Even Pray has things that adults can earn.
Excellent. Excellent point. Okay. So go ahead, Stephen.
Well, what I was going to say is, I've taught it multiple times where I tag teamed, where there were two of us and we would talk for an hour before, sometime throughout the week, an hour before, and we each study and we would swap lessons off. The other person was always prepared. So if something came up, she was a NICU nurse, and if something came up in the NICU and she had to go in, I would teach the class even if she was scheduled, back and forth. And I thought that team approach was really good. And virtually, I've used my green screen. I put on a Where's Waldo costume and had a Where's Waldo scene in the background. And I would caution you to think about the age of your groups, because I did that with one group and it went over really well. I did that with another group and did not turn off annotations. So when I shared my screen, I got an interesting annotation on my screen from some kid. Just thoughts.
Be careful. Also be creative. You can be creative. You don't have to. Yeah, that's great. That's good stuff. So the last slide we have here are just to make you aware of some other upcoming faith-based events. There's one coming up just in 2 weeks up in Chicago. And Jim Leppard, are you still with us?
Yes, I am.
Good. So I appreciate you notifying me this just yesterday or a couple of days ago. You guys up in the Boy Scout Council up there doing this virtual faith walk of faith. You want to take a minute and share, folks, what that's about?
I'd sure like to. The Catholic and the Jewish committees of the Northeast Illinois Council of Boy Scouts have gotten together and produced what they call a virtual walk of faith. They did it first in August. It was a success, so they decided to repeat it. What is very interesting about this is they have scouts conducting it. A scout is a moderator. Another scout does the transitions between the various sessions. Each of the breakout rooms are conducted by scouts who have undergone some training about the questions to be discussed. Parents are welcome to come, and so are interested leaders from around the country. I was asked to join them in this effort because of the Methodist Church connection to eight councils that we have. And we've done a fair amount of publicity for it, and I think we're going to find a very interesting audience. I'd encourage all of you to take a look. This explores the five major traditions of faith in the world: Catholicism, Protestants, Hindu, Muslim, and Jewish.
Awesome. No, that's good. I appreciate you sharing that. I went ahead and put the link to your website in the chat room if you guys want to download that or save that. I'll also include that in my follow-up email, just in case. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it. I think a lot of you guys attended our Scouters Religious Academy. That's the patch in my back screen there, if you haven't seen that before. We're having our next one on April 24th. I think some of you know that traditionally that was an in-person event, and we virtualized it this past spring because COVID took everything out, including that event, not realizing how many people would show, and we had a bunch of people show. So we're going to do two next year. The one in April, we're not sure if it's going to be live, meaning in Atlanta, Georgia, or if it's going to be virtual. We're ready to do either one. We got the space reserved at Peachy Road United Methodist Church. If we do that one live in person in April, we're going to do one next October virtually. So one of the two will be virtual. So we'll make sure we let everybody who attends tonight and the previous academy know what the ones. And if you're in Atlanta, great. Last year, 18 months ago, when we did the one here in Atlanta virtually, we had people from eight different states drive in, including Jim, who just spoke, and then Carolyn from Texas and Stephen from Tennessee. People drove or flew in for it. So even if it's a person, we'd invite you to come down. So just let us know if you're interested. Also next July, Philmont Training Center has their faith week over a 2-week period. So most of the faith groups are July 11th through the 16th. The Catholic week is the following week. And so you know, we'd encourage you to go to Philmont's website and look up for PTC, Philmont Training Center, and look up the particular week that you're most interested in. But the Methodists, we do have a program that week. And I know many of you guys already signed up. We already have like 28 people who verbally committed to come in. We hope to get 100 to celebrate our 100th anniversary of the Methodist Church in Scouting with the Boy Scouts of America. And also this coming year, 21, that'll be the 100th anniversary of the Girl Scouts partnership with the Methodist Church. So we'll have a lot of things to celebrate next year. So we hope to see you guys there. So that's basically the program. I don't know, Malcolm, if there's any last questions that we'd want to address before we sign out. Is there anything else?
No questions, but there's excellent conversation in the chat room about recognition of scouts, which is highly important as well, too. So I encourage everybody to just kind of glance through the chat there on how various people have recognized scouts, either on Scout Sunday or in other forums outside of that.
Excellent. Well, thank you all very much. Thank you, panelists. You've done a wonderful job. And thank you, Malcolm, for moderating that, because I would be totally confused trying to look in that chat room right now. So And so thank you all again, and just look for an email from me, if not tonight, tomorrow, with all these details. If you have any questions or you can't remember something that we talked about, just shoot me an email and then I will follow up with you. All right. Thanks, guys, and good night.
All right. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
You bet.
Good night. Thank you very much.
You bet.
Good night. Thank you, everybody.
Hey, good night, Cara. I'm going to hang tight here just for a second in case there's anything, because I want to make sure I download this chat stream and finish recording.
You want us to hang in? For-